First of all, do a massive welcome on this beautiful day. I'm sitting in the sun. It's the best day. Welcome to everyone to the Virdis Leadership Series. And I think we've done, well, we've done a lot, haven't we? How many have we done, Maggie?
I had to count. I think we're on 12 now.
So we've done 12. So we did in the last since lockdown and all the locking everything down, we've done 12 and we've meandered through so many fascinating experiences. And we're back today to have a really fascinating experience with Paul Peter, who I love and is a great guy, and will be able to tell us some interesting things. But before we get on to that, I'm going to get Natalie, just who's our CEO. Where is Natalie? To welcome everybody. So Natalie, can you welcome everyone, or has Natalie dropped off? I think Natalie's
I
unfortunately
think she's
dropped off.
having connection issues. She
So
might
I'm going to go straight
no,
in
I'm
and
here.
yeah,
Tony, I'm here.
Natalie is still here.
I'm here.
Welcome.
But I've been bounced out and I'm back, but my connection is extremely low. So I switched off my camera and I do apologize for this. So if you can't see my terrible face. Anyway, welcome everyone. It's a pleasure to have you. And of course, it's a way of connecting or being together in those times. But it's also, I think, something which has now gained its own status in terms of bringing something interesting, something to debate, something to think about with regards to leadership in the biotech environment. So welcome everyone, and I hope you'll enjoy our host, our guest speaker, Paul Peter Tak, who is the CEO of Candel Therapeutics and an excellent friend and a wonderful man. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. So on that note, the plan today is we're going to do 30 minutes with Paul Peter, then we're going to break into some breakout groups where you can get a bit more free and easy about conversation. But Paul Peter, first of all, welcome, my friend. We know it's early in the morning, so thank goodness that you're someone who doesn't sleep too deeply. And welcome to you. Maybe you could say who you are, what you do, and where you are, Paul Peter, before we move into your talk on leadership. Paul Peter.
Okay, well, good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you might be, everybody. I'm Paul Peter Tak. I'm currently the CEO of a company called Candel Therapeutics, based in Needham, not too far from Boston, in the greater Boston area. And we are a clinical stage immunotherapy company focused on solid tumors. So we have ongoing clinical trials, six, in fact, at this time, ranging from phase one, two, and three in multiple tumors. Think of brain tumors, high-grade glioma, non-small cell lung cancer. Patients were failed everything, including immune checkpoint inhibitors, pancreatic cancer, and different trials in prostate cancer, actually much earlier in the whole treatment paradigm. Before this time, I was a venture partner at Flagship Pioneering. I think everybody nowadays knows Flagship because they created Moderna. And I was the CEO of one of their biotech companies called Kintai Therapeutics, which is now called Senda Biosciences. And before that time, I was the global head of development and the chief immunology officer for GlaxoSmithKline, where I left behind a portfolio in late-stage development of at least 10 medicines that are still alive and in late stage or have been approved in oncology, infectious diseases, and immunoinflammation. And before that time, I have had a long career in academia as a professor of medicine and the head of the founding chair, actually, of the Department of Clinical Immunology and Rheumatology. So I'm a physician scientist who at some point decided to join the industry to have potentially a bigger impact.
Fantastic, Paul Peter. So great pleasure. And so you've moved from big pharma. You did one company that you built, and then you've built another one, and you've taken it to an interesting point. Now, so you have played around with organizations, as we call it. And so you've got a few essences of what you've learned in your journey about organizations to give to us today. So maybe we could just listen to your thoughts on what you've been doing and your experiences and insights on organizations.
Yeah, okay, I will do that. because I mean I've created many organizations, two academic labs or maybe three, and I've also always done something in parallel because I easily get bored. So to keep myself focused, I've always had a parallel career. So it may sound strange, but when I was in training to become an internist, I created an occupational medicine company from scratch. I have to admit, without knowing very much about the topic, but I do know that in the end, we had clients like Akzo Nobel and became successful, went a little bit out of hand and I sold it. When I was a professor of rheumatology in Amsterdam at the same time, I started a clinic in the Middle East, in Dubai, the Dubai Bone and Joint Center, which became the prime referral center for the whole Middle East in orthopedic surgery, rheumatology, sports medicine, and rehab, except for Israel, because they have fantastic healthcare. And then, of course, I created several biotech companies, several of which I've not mentioned here. So on a Sunday afternoon, when I was kind of alone in Cambridge, Massachusetts, away from my family, I thought, what is the common theme here, right? What has worked for me? And it could be slightly different for somebody else.
Go ahead. Get on to that, Paul Peter. I mean, obviously, you've been a bit of a restless soul, and you're curious about many things. And do you think that is a major driving force to actually build an organization?
Probably it is. So I'm maybe a little bit restless on the one hand. On the other hand, I'm super focused and consistent. So like I've been a professor of medicine in Amsterdam for 20 years. I stayed at GlaxoSmithKline for 7 years. But I have always a lot of ideas and the drive to create things where I see an opportunity. And sometimes it's not enough in the main job. So I've canalized that basically in parallel jobs. And it has always been good for the main job because you learn new things. For example, with my occupational medicine company, this is in the 90s, right? I learned so much about quality, industry standard quality, that I decided to introduce that into my research line that was focused on how do we take biopsies from patients with rheumatological diseases? How do you analyze them? How do you store them? How do you do immunohistochemistry? How do you analyze the data using computer-assisted image analysis? All according to industry standard systems that was extremely unlikely in the days. And it put me in a position to basically become the prime center for experimental medicine clinical trials, where we used biomarkers and where we could show to the industry, we work like a company ourselves. We had all the quality systems, we had all the thing systems and all of that. Nobody did that in academia. Just one example that it was not, it's a way to canalize my creativity, I guess, in building organizations, but it has also always reinforced the main job. And there are common themes when I look back on this Sunday, Sunday afternoon in Cambridge, Massachusetts, being alone, when I asked, what is it that works for me? And I thought of it as a temple, basically, right? As you can see on the slide, a temple with a roof and a temple with a foundation. And I decided to put 10 pillars there. Of course, that is a nice number, 10. It could have been 12 or 14 or maybe 8. There's always a prioritization, but it's a good starting point for a dialogue about which are the principles that could work. And I think for any organization that you create, whether it's an academic lab, where you operate in a broader environment with colleagues who will also always consider you as competitors, or whether you build a biotech company or another company, or whether you operate in a pharmaceutical company, I think trust is the major part of the foundation of any organization. And I think leaders need to take their trust creating levels to a completely new level to be successful. And what are some of the key components of trust? First, it is ability, right? That you need to show that you're able to do your job. But it's also about showing that you do what you say that you do. This is crucial, right? If you say, well, this is what I'm going to deliver, this is the timeline, and you consistently do not deliver, then that's a huge trust breaker. Or simple things, if you're always too late for a meeting, it's not okay, right? And it is a trust breaker. So ability is a key component and delivery of building trust. The second is generosity, I think, just being kind to people, even if you don't want to get something out of it, is very important. Benevolence, you might say, right? Integrity is very important. Go ahead.
Now, this concept of benevolence and benevolent autocracy, really. I mean, you must have seen that not many leaders actually are very benevolent.
Yeah, I agree. And that's a great point. And without becoming too specific, you always need to stay true to your principles, right? And there may be a certain period in time when you can bear this, that you work with people who are maybe not benevolent, but at some point the balance is not positive enough to stay there. And then it's time to carry on, unless you're able to change the system or the people around you or above you. This is very important. So we are all free to create our own career, basically, right? And to decide where we want to have an impact. And if you work in an environment that is low in terms of trust and generosity and benevolence and integrity, then you need to ask yourself the question, do you want to stay there and lose your emotional energy every day?
But I think, Paul Peter, people get trapped, don't they? They get trapped.
Yeah, it's not easy what I say, but it is very important. And I've changed, and as you may have seen in my career, the cycles have become shorter. That doesn't mean that I had negative experiences necessarily, but sometimes you do a big change project and you think after 2 years, it's done, and it may be a reason to move on. I think it's certainly with the younger generations, younger than myself, it becomes much more normal to invent your own career, maybe by just playing it by ear, actually, but always ask the question, is this the best place for me on many levels, including on an emotional level?
Yeah, I love it, love it. So your next slide, my friend.
I'll just talk briefly about collective intelligence, which is the roof, right? And this is a very important concept. And maybe the best way to think about it is to compare a team not with a family. Sometimes people say, oh, we have such a positive culture, we are a family. I don't believe companies are families. I'm a big fan of creating a positive atmosphere and having fun and all of that. But it's not a family, right? We're not married to each other. We're not each other's siblings or whatever it is. We are members of a top sports team. And when you think about, let's say, football, as we call it in Europe, right? Soccer, as they call it here. There are examples of top teams, right, that did not necessarily have the mega superstars, but that were able to create a form of collective intelligence, super teamwork, clearly intelligence that was more, in this case about sports, more than the sum of all the individual contributors to it, that made them win a major World Cup or whatever it is, right? It's exactly the same in science, it's the same in any business, and it's actually real science behind this, actually published in the scientific journal Science. So it's very important to be thoughtful about creating a culture that fosters collective intelligence, which includes respectful and candid debate within the team, which is also a feature of high performing teams. Without conflict, I don't think you can have a high performing team. Where everybody can contribute to intellectual team performance. Another key component of collective intelligence is diversity. Obviously, diversity in terms of gender, ethnic background, what have you, but also cognitive diversity. So that brings me to a deeper discussion of some of these pillars, right? And I will be very brief, and we can speak about them in more detail, and basically there are references for each of them. So I started to speak about diversity. It's key to build a great, diverse and multidisciplinary leadership team that can create the organization of the future. And you need to have different perspectives, I think, in each and every organization. So, and then I'm a big supporter of starting with building strong leadership teams first, then set the strategy, then articulate the mission and prepare for the future organization. Of course, within the limits of the remit of your organization. So I think Jim Collins has described it in the following way, right? Think of a kind of van, right, minivan or bus, and you put it somewhere, and then you're going to find the best people to be in the bus. And the remit is, we are going west, right? So I will say it from the US perspective, we're going west, but then together you will decide whether it will be in the end San Diego or Los Angeles or San Francisco. And you will also find out how you get there. And you won't give your team necessarily a map, but you will give them a compass. So this is the principle of building these teams and build organizations top down. So and that's what I've done with Candel in the last year. I brought a completely new executive team into the company within the first 3 or 4 months. And then we started to think about middle management and change the company.
But I suppose there's two dynamics. One, that to do this often can take time, and you've got maybe the brutal commercial forces that force you to get to value inflection points and don't allow this. The second thing, Paul Beach, you've got to have the money to be to rebuild, and a lot of organizations struggle with that.
There are always limitations, and you need to operate within the limitations. So I agree. So building a strong leadership team, maybe two people actually, right? So let me go back to my old academic medical center days. I was very proud to become a professor at a young age and the head of the department, but actually I had no personnel on day one and no budget and no patients. And actually the institute was not very supportive because they thought rheumatology was kind of boring specialty, and which it has clearly been shown not to be. And I decided to bring in one key member. So there was Martin Kram, who you may know. And it was just us then, right? And we started to write grants and build the organization. Actually, Martin became senior vice president of AstraZeneca and IFGSK, and he has had also a very successful career. So it can be small, it can be larger. So at Candel, we were a company and are a company with 6 ongoing clinical trials. But it was completely led top down by 2 founders. And it was urgent to build a multidisciplinary team, including a chief business officer, a very strong chief financial officer to get prepared for an IPO, a chief regulatory officer, because imagine all the regulatory aspects and risks, right, and analyze the risk, and head of people and culture, as I call it, HR, to really focus actually on building this strong, diverse, high-performing team, et cetera, et cetera. But you're right, Tony, it's always within the limitations of what you can do. Another book that I would strongly recommend in this context, if you want to learn more about this principle of building top-down, is Powerful, written by the previous HR head of Netflix. So we can learn quite a lot, not only from biotech and pharma companies, we can learn quite a lot of from tech companies like Netflix, which has been incredibly successful and imaginative. I think there's also a famous slide deck that's somewhere on the internet that has been produced in the past by the head of HR, whose name I forgot at this early time in the morning here, but you can easily find it. Netflix, Powerful, it's fantastic. It doesn't mean that it's a recipe for success, but it is very interesting to at least think about these aspects. So that's the first pillar I wanted to discuss. I will just briefly pause and check whether there's anything else you want to discuss here, Tony.
No, let's move on because you've got lots of good stuff here.
The second pillar is to create a strong culture based on freedom and accountability. And I just want to mention that this may be one of the reasons why most pharmaceutical companies are not more successful than they are. Because the culture that you need in late stage development and commercialization is fundamentally different from the culture that you need to create in early discovery. In late stage development and commercialization, everything is highly regulated, and it's about flawless execution, basically. And rightly so, it's not necessarily the mindset that will lead you to complete new discovery. But to give the freedom that you need to foster a creative and productive discovery organization, you also need to hold people accountable, because it can't be a complete playground, right? So freedom cannot exist without accountability. If you want to discover something new and innovate, you cannot have accountability without freedom. So this is a very fine balance to achieve, I think. in any organization, it always needs a lot of discussion. And it is, again, different in early discovery versus early development versus late stage development and commercialization. So the fine balance and the goal is to achieve alignment with this team and to hold them accountable without excessive control. I can't emphasize enough how important this is and how difficult. So you always need to talk about this. What I want to see in my teams is that they are inspired, which helps is to actually have a clear mission, right? If you work in the biomedical industry or in healthcare, it's clear that it all needs to be about the patient, right? If you focus on the patient, then there's a clear mission. That's also, I think, the best way to create value, because if you innovate by focusing on innovations, you will do things that are actually relevant. I want people to display creativity, to challenge each other in a respectful way, and to act with greater efficiency and purpose than you often see. So this is about high-performing team behaviors, and to generally collaborate and to get rid of the egos, which are very often inhibiting our progress. Certainly when people come from academia, so I made that transition, and I've coached and mentored many people there, where they need to understand, to go back to the sport team, if you're in this football team, who cares who gets the ball into the goal, right? In the end, what people will remember is that this team has won the World Cup.
There is a huge modifier in our world, Paul Peter, which is this thing called being a scientist. And a lot of what you're describing here is not the innate, the innateness, if that's a word, of the scientist. So how do you take somebody who's has, you know, introverted loner, you know, likes data more than people, and make them this?
That's a good question. So first, you are right. This is often different in academia. And I want to say that it should not be different in academia. So I ran my department that I built from scratch actually according to the same principles. And people were very surprised by that. We were completely open-minded by collaborations and everything. If we didn't have a technique in-house, rather than developing everything ourselves, I would actually go to others and we would just publish it together. And I think this is one of the reasons that I became one of the most highly cited rheumatologists in the world. I still am, actually. I'm in the top three of the world. And it's not necessarily because I'm so smart. I think in part it's based on how I organized myself and how we were completely open-minded. And then at some point, the academic medical center leadership thought that they were smart and they wanted to copy more like an American model, which was just a very, very wrong idea. So they introduced the PI model, the principal investigator model, in all the departments, including my own big department. We had then 120 FTEs by then. That meant that for these people, it suddenly became much more important to be the last author, the senior author, and they became more egoistic, and they started to collaborate less. One of the reasons, actually, that I decided to leave academia, because it was completely the wrong thing to do. So how does that work in an industry? In a company like GSK, where very many people are chemists, many of these chemists are actually rather introverted, and they can be great leaders. So the first, to come back to your question, is to appreciate that not every leader needs to be an extroverted person, that typical prototypic leader that we may have in mind, but that other leaders with a very different style may be equally successful. And definitely if they want to become like type 5 leaders, as Jim Collins describes it, right? People who like to almost lead from behind can be extremely successful, often more successful. So it starts with the recognition that not everybody needs to be the same, and that you support these people. It recently happened to me. I was interviewing somebody for a leadership role at Candel, and then my team said, yeah, he seems to be rather introverted and this and that, and for a role in manufacturing. And I said, well, the big question is, why is that a problem? Why do we all need to be the same, right? Actually, we need to foster a culture of diversity on every level.
Fantastic. Let's move on because of time.
Yeah, absolutely. So the third is to manage energy. So I think most of you are probably European, so this may be easier for you to understand than for people in the US who believe that they always need to be at the job, actually, right? And actually sometimes quite ineffective. And I believe that you need to manage the energy of the team. And you need to make sure that people have time to step back, relax, reconnect with family and friends, see the big picture and broaden the horizon. And I think it's more a European thing than an American thing, where people are probably afraid that they lose their job if they go away for a holiday, a summer break for 2 weeks. I won't deny that I've not been able to have any break actually since a year. But I mean, this is just a crazy thing, doing an IPO and changing, driving massive change in the company. But in general, I would strongly recommend this. I also believe it leads to better ideas based on how the brain works. A lot of our brain activity is actually subconscious processing, and you may get better ideas when you're hiking in the mountains or sitting in your bath or whatever you do, or on the bicycle. So this is about managing the energy of the team and yourself. And that leads me immediately to the next pillar, that innovation often starts by looking beyond the edge rather than being guided to stay on a defined path. I write it like this, inspired by a thought that I had. So we have at least two people with a Greek name on the call. When I was actually with my backpack, in my backpack days, walking in the mountains on Crete in Greece, right? And it was night, and there was just the moonlight, and there was this very small path, and it was difficult to see. And I realized, what everybody understands who understands how the eye works, that it was just a little bit easier if I would not focus on the path, but just look next to it, right? Because then you have better vision in the night. And this is also true, I think, if you want to discover new things in science. You just need to look next to what you're actually looking for. And this is the concept that I call lateral thinking, which may lead to very disruptive discoveries. I'll give you a very brief example. When I was in Amsterdam, we had a biotech company focused on gene therapy called Atrogen. At some point, I thought, let's play this pharmaceutical company on a micro scale. We developed a new platform together with Galapagos to identify new targets for gene therapy, intra-articular gene therapy for rheumatoid arthritis patients. To make a very long story short, we published this in detail. I've given interviews about this in the context of serendipity. I actually found a molecule, which is the alpha-7 nicotinic acetylcholine receptor, and realized that that plays a key role in signaling by the vagus nerve. And ultimately, it led to a bioelectronics approach, electrical stimulation of the vagus nerve in mice, in rats, and then in patients. And we've demonstrated that this can help actually to treat therapy-resistant inflammation. So it's an example of looking beyond the edge and being open to things that you were actually not looking for. So a fifth pillar is to implement a solution-oriented management approach. And typical questions that you ask when you base yourself on solution-oriented management are, what is going well? And you can even ask people to indicate this on a scale from, let's say, 0 to 10, right? 0 is very bad, and 10 is just outstanding. Can't be better. Imagine that you are discussing with your team something that's really difficult, right? Things are not going well. And you ask the leader of that domain, of that function, so how do you think it's going, right? Can you score it for me from 0 to 10? And imagine they say, well, it's a 4, right? It's really low. And then you say, okay, it's a 4, well, thank you. So can you explain to me why it's not a 3? And that puts people in a positive solution. Probably releases some dopamine. You focus on what's going well. Question could be improved opportunities rather than so ideas are weak and that are unnecessary, and where you think, well, that's a that's not a priority, it's difficult to fix, call it a limitation and get rid of it if possible, and move on and focus on the things that that can be improved. So that's about solution-oriented management. Then another principle that's very important is to be decisive. Sometimes it's better to make a decision, a bad decision, than no decision. You can't cycle forever. I remember when I joined GSK, and we had a meeting about expansion of indications for Benlysta. The team presented the slide deck. And then I asked, how long has this slide deck been around? And it was for 2 years. And nobody had made the decision. So I said, well, we're going to lock up all the stakeholders for one day, and we will not leave without making a decision. And then that's what we're going to do until we have new data. So there's nothing more painful, I think, and paralyzing to an organization than not making decisions. So make the best decision possible, pressure test it, do peer review, whatever it needs to be. But at some point, you need to move on. Yeah, go ahead.
Often, Paul Peter, politics is the issue. So, I mean, do you think you have to be a great politician to be a good leader?
I don't think so. But you need to understand how decisions are made. So let's say if you think about so-called politics in a big pharmaceutical company, you need to understand what the decision-making process is. And there's a management structure. Let's say when I arrived at GSK, I started as the global head of R&D for immunoinflammation, everything in autoimmunity. So you make management decisions in your team. But there's also a governance structure. There may be a lot of politics going on over there. And these are the investment boards, right? Because if you're going to say, well, we're going to do this phase 3 clinical trial and it will cost £160 million, it's clear that you won't make that decision in isolation. There will need to be a governance decision. So what did it look like at the time at GSK? There was the scientific review board. Right? This was all reviewed from a scientific perspective. And then if it passed that point, it would go to the portfolio investment board, where the voice of R&D came together with the voice of commercial, and the CEO would be there. So I made sure, and there were many other boards, discovery investment boards and this and that. So I made sure that I became a member of all the boards, of all the governance boards beyond my management role. And I became the chair of the scientific review board. And of course you want to do it in a very fair way, but at least there I could end politics. For example, my boss was in my team in the scientific review board. I can tell you that made me feel slightly uncomfortable.
But you could argue, Paul Peter, you were a skillful politician going onto the boards.
Well, maybe, but I would not call it politics. I would call it trying to do the right thing, actually, and give everybody the right information and actually end politics. So what happened before I became the chair of the SRB was that the previous chair, the head of R&D, would anchor the discussion. So we would have 10 members of the SRB, the scientific review board. The team was going to present, and then he would start with his comments, quite clearly steering in one direction. And that is very political, I think. What I did when I became the SRB chair, I would give everybody the word. He would be the second last to speak up, actually, my boss. And I would be the last, and I would just integrate everything that I'd heard from everybody, and then overlay it with my own judgment and then translate that into a proposal. So yeah, of course it depends on what you call politics, but you need to understand the process, I think, and make sure that all stakeholders are managed in a proper way.
I mean, it's skillful rhetoric really. I mean, it's a Socrates kind of thing. So let's move on to the next thing. Next ones.
Pillar number 7. This is again about decision making. So you will see there are 3 pillars about decision making, because I think this is very important. The first was about persistence. The second is is about the question, at which level do you need to make decisions? And it's very important to be super thoughtful about it. It's a huge source of confusion. Any organization, as a general principle, decision. Who owns the decision is not necessarily the decision maker. So what does that mean? Can you still hear me? Because my connection is unstable.
We've got you back, Paul Peter.
Yeah, okay. So push them down to the lowest level, which may be actually the CEO level, right? Some decisions need to come to me. But many decisions can be taken at other levels. Why? Because first, it's more efficient, because if I need to make all the decisions, it will cause delays. But second, if they are taken at the lowest appropriate level, better decisions will be taken. So we need to be liberated from the thought that we will always have the best insight and that we will always make the best decision, which is definitely not the case. So at the same time, it's clear that some things need to require an integration of multiple functional areas to leverage again the collective intelligence and weigh perspectives and priorities. For example, if you want to prioritize your portfolio, you need to look at it through different lenses, the scientific lens, the lens of the medical unmet need, practical and logistical lenses, are we even able to do it? Developability, are there, for example, biomarkers that will make it possible to get the readout early on, commercial considerations, etc. So that's where you need to bring a team together, like a governance board, as I just described. So one of the things I did at Candel is creating what I now call the science and investment board, that we just sit together for 1.5 hours and we won't leave without having made governance decisions. And that's, and then that's what we're going to do. And then finally, about decision making, there are three essential ingredients: listening, judgment, and explaining, right? Listening is probably the most important part of communication. I think it's also important to come back to the idea of walking in the hills, on the hills of Crete in the middle of the night, in the moonlight. It's kind of a romantic thing, right? These are the moments that you may get your best ideas. So intuitive judgment, which is, I think, a combination of subconscious processing and observing, is often a very important starting point in decision making. So trust your intuition, but then test it, because you may be wrong. And there are two steps that I try to be very deliberate about. First, my internal peer review process, where I try to make the thought conscious and weigh the pros and cons of it. And then the third step is to really talk to other people that you trust, right? Peer review. And for example, at GSK, when I was the head of immunology, I created a very strong external immunology board with professors of immunology. And every time I needed to make an important decision, for example, about business development, new opportunities, I would call 2 or 3 of these guys and ladies and ask for their judgment. And then I would decide whether I agree or disagree with what I heard to make a decision. So these are key elements, I think, of decision-making. Listening is very important. And I would say in the biomedical industry, listen to the patient in the first place, which is an important driver of innovation, often more than scientists or physicians.
I'm thinking about, we've got 2 more pillars and then we need to move into the questions. So let's move in, let's do your last 2 and then I'm getting some questions that are coming up, so I want to get some questions, but I also want to try and get people into smaller rooms. So your last 2 points, really, people.
Okay, so I started to talk about pillar 9, so they're all connected, as you see. So external peer review is critical, and in any organization, biotech or pharma, always realize that most scientists, even if you're huge, right, do not work for you. So get access to all the others as well. And finally, focus and prioritization. There's always the basic law of economics, right? That there's scarcity, so you can't do everything. Place resources, time and energy behind the projects you believe will enable you to achieve optimal outcomes that will create value for your organization. And that's where I will pause because of time and go back to you, Tony.
Fantastic. If we bring back the screen, take down the slides, Paul Peter. And firstly, may I thank Paul Peter for a fabulous talk. If we thank him in our traditional way, which is highly intuitive clapping. But what I want to open up the questions, and then I want to go into the smaller groups, because then we can discuss it, because that's what we try and do. But